in comprehensive care, I have introduced is fat mapping. And what I do is I do get a sonography done in which we do 9 quadrant fat thickness. We also measure preperitoneal fat, intra-abdominal fat, liver and other organ fat. And if the visceral fat in these patients is more, then we do not promise them a flat abdomen at all. Or sometimes we can decline liposuction altogether and take consultation on metabolic management. This is an example. Her BMI was almost 36. She underwent abdominoplasty. After 2 years, she had gained 4 kgs. And as you can see here, her thighs are look well toned, but there is deposit here. And when we did the fat mapping, we realized that it was intra-abdominal fat deposit and the patient was sent for metabolic management. So this is the trust you have to build, that if they have for again, they should be able to come back and they should find their solution. So these are the results. So, large volume liposuction program at our clinic is diet, exercise, procedure and follow-up, and you can maintain these very good results. Another example of use of body abdominal fat mapping is this small volume liposuction. This is a result in 2018, but immediately she got pregnant, and now in type of fat deposit. This is the lateral view and she wanted this flattened, but when we did the fat map, see that the fat thickness here is barely 2 cm in the epigastric region, and she has got a divarication of the recti. So actually she needs abdominoplasty. So this is how you can use this fat mapping sonography. Another screenshot you can take, these are the points in clinical examination of a large volume liposuction patient, and these are the investigations that are essential. APTT, partial thromboplastin time, is very essential because it will show the hidden factor deficiencies and other anomalies. Fitness by physician is mandatory because we don't auscultate our patients or we don't see other things. Some patients can be on some medications about which we don't understand. So all this, if it is taken care by a physician, we are much safer. We all photographs make markings and record the measurements. So this is my protocol. I ask them to take bath with betadine soap, liquid diet, paint with betadine, then also apply crepe bandages up to the knees during surgery, and afterwards I put them on DVT pump. The patient is painted in standing position. I will show you how it is. I used to put the patient in prone position if back has to be done, but now I put them side to side positions mostly, and we need good staff to so this is how we paint the patient, and we drape the table completely in sterile drapes, and then this is how the sister puts legging, and then the anesthetist washes up completely and then gives the spinal and epidural anesthesia. This is the microarray power assisted liposuction. Do listen to the noise, but it is very safe and effective. You can see a very nice and clear aspirate without much blood. Temperature management in the OT is essential because effort you feel, and you tend to reduce the AC temperature as much as possible, but the patient starts feeling cold, so you may either have heating blankets or manage it by wrapping blankets around the head of the patient. Post-operative care, patient has to be hydrated, catheter, keep the patient warm. Then avoid hypotension, avoid this is like internal burns, and if you give colloids, the edema will last for too long. And post-operative analgesia is very important for a good patient experience, and I give it by syringe pump, a continuous drip till the next morning. So these are some of our recent results. We are now trying to improve our contours. This is done using power assisted liposuction only, but a better contour. So we must remember that women face hormonal havoc. The fat accumulation reduces the efficiency of movement and burdens the joints. It is not only because of overeating that women get fat, and liposuction plays an important role in improving the quality of their role. And so it is our burden of duty to keep these patients safe so that women get advantage of this beautiful procedure. So the importance of comprehensive care cannot be overemphasized. This is another girl who came for liposuction. They are usually jeered by the peers, but after liposuction you can see the wonderful contour. I have also done some amount of fat grafting on the buttocks. You can see a very nice contour here also. And when they become center of attraction, they are very happy, they are very motivated. So we should be sensitive to the needs of these patients, because it is a life-changing experience for them. Keep the patient safe. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you, madam, for that wonderful presentation. It was really awesome, because you have actually dealt with almost the entire things about liposuction. And it is actually, if you see in the examination point of view, more and more exams are actually having questions on liposuction. And you have actually dealt with it very beautifully, madam, because all the latest developments in liposuction also you have actually mentioned. Yeah. I'll just check out if there are any questions.
Yeah. I have not covered, because that is more in my abdominoplasty lecture. But seroma, they can just write a mail to me and I can give a very nice write ready made answer I can give.
Yeah, madam. Dr. George, he has mentioned super presentation for laser lipo. 50 to 65 degree will cause damage to normal cells besides fat cells. How yes. can we be see more? Okay, maybe sure that there is not much internal damage happening.
That is the downside of laser and vaser, that you cannot really measure the temperature and damage you are causing. That is why I think radio frequency liposuction has got a temperature sensor, and it has got an alarm. When you are exceeding the temperature, the machine will turn off automatically. This doesn't happen in laser liposuction. And there has been a reported case of rhabdomyolysis also. And there is definitely a possibility of excessive fibrosis leading to severe contraction and painful induration, for which there have been reports of triamcinolone injection being required for that.
Yeah, I don't know.
But usually the laser machine also has a cutoff point, but there is no monitoring. The machines are.
Yeah, madam, because you have been using all the various methodologies of liposuction, so probably you are one of the best people to answer this particular question. It's like you have mentioned the advantages and disadvantages of various techniques. But for a beginner, let us say that all our postgraduates and young plastic surgeons, when they are actually going to start off their journey in liposuction, what would be the ideal liposuction machine to actually acquire? Would it be a power-assisted one, or just a suction-assisted, or ultrasonic, vaser, laser, water jet, or no RF also?
See, for tall and burly people, they can still wait to collect some money and buy a machine later. But girls and, you know, more delicate people should definitely invest in power assisted machine. See, my power, the reason I'm saying this is because my power assisted machine has lasted me for 13 years. So it is a very good investment, whereas razor and laser, these are little more delicate machines. So my own laser machine, I was the first person to buy laser machine in 2000 in my area, and that counted off within 1 year. So in 2000, that 12 lakh rupees which I had meticulously collected and invested, that went down the dump, and then I got a very big setback. So I do feel that invest in the machines which are definitely last enough, they don't have too much of disposable cost and sturdy machines. The advantage of power assisted that but you can buy a complementary heating devices, non-invasive heating devices which are easily available, like a non-ablative radio frequency to tighten the skin and give some improvement over only power assisted result. Where if your razor or laser machine counts off, then it is really a big problem for a young person. Power assisted machine is a workhorse, and it is anyway required after razor and laser. So better to begin with a power assisted machine which is good and sturdy.
Yeah, madam, just before we actually go in for more questions, I just wanted to clarify few terminologies, because I see quite a bit of postgraduates asking, sir, what is this? What is this, like that? So one is a simple thing. What is cellulite? How is it different from just fat?
Yeah, so cellulite is herniation of the subdermal fat into the dermis, causing surface irregularity. So there is puckered appearance of the skin because the dermis has gaps through which the subdermal fat has herniated. It is a very difficult to treat condition, and Toledo has designed a pickle for cannula. So it is like this, you know, at the tip is bifid and this part is a little sharp. So you can enter and cut those fibrous septa which pull the skin down so that skin comes up and the hernia is released. You don't reduce that hernia, but you elevate the skin envelope.
And by removing the fibrosis.
Yes.
Yeah, tethered part you removed. Yeah. Yeah. Yes, ma'am. You were saying something else, no?
Yeah. Other thing is laser is the other modality which helps in treatment of cellulite. And this is because it will destroy the cells. So there is a paper presented by Dr. Goldman sometime in after 2000, in which he used INDIAG laser to effectively treat the cellulite. But otherwise, successful treatment is quite difficult. But you can use a pickle for cannula, release the fibrous septa that tether to the skin, and you can do some autologous fat graft. That is why it is said that before beginning any liposuction, have 50 to 100 cc fat aspirated in a syringe and keep it ready to take care of the irregularities that might develop.
Yeah. Madam, the second terminology question is, how do you define large volume liposuction?
Actually, according to the American Society of Plastic Surgeons, anything above 5 liters is large volume. But in India, when I discussed my kids, I realized that most of us have to remove minimum 7 to 9 cc's to have some difference to the patient. So it is a unpublished convention that anything above 7 to 8 liters is large volume. But at the same time, we must remember that even a small volume liposuction does trigger inflammatory cascade and result in complications. So we should not take any liposuction as a small trivial surgery.
The next question is by Dr. Sharika. She has asked, it is said that cellulite cannot be removed completely by liposuction. Yeah, but in your presentation, you mentioned that VASER and RF helps in cellulite treatment as well. In your experience, which is the best liposuction modality that focuses on cellulite treatment? I think you have already answered that in the previous.
The only thing I would like to mention is the cost of laser and VASER and radio frequency machines. It is about 250,000.
Yeah, and now RF, I think, machine is almost 50 lakhs, I think, 52 or something. No, 25. Some, or 25.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay.
I feel that we should build groups and teams. I have been writing about it. So whoever wants, they can visit setups of senior people who have machines, and they can learn with initial cases and they can do their own cases independently. So group practice is the answer to the cost of these machines.
True, because and with the technology that is actually coming, like every other year, you've got some new technology coming, and if you want to keep updated, I think you should be actually working as a team so that you can actually get newer machines together. But then again, many people are scared to go in for group practice also for various reasons.
But we should overcome that, because if you see abroad, they have really set structure for group practice, which is beneficial to everyone. And they can keep records, write papers. That is where we lack, because we are single soldiers. It is very difficult to keep data and present it and have a consensus on things.
I think probably let the younger people see light in this particular suggestion, and probably hopefully they would be able to do, because I know so many centers in Kerala which have started group practice and they do extremely well in whichever field that they were actually having expertise. So they were actually doing extremely well when they are actually having group practice.
And
the next question is,
I do feel, sorry to interrupt you, but I do feel reconstructive aesthetic, many specialties should come together. You know, like if one person expert in maxillofacial surgery, reconstructive surgery, aesthetic, the talent and skills also should be pulled, not only machines. So that there should be holistic plastic surgery centers all over the country.
Yeah, madam. Next question by Dr. George. Again, he is also, ma'am, if aspirate is 14 liters, how much weight loss would actually result immediately, since the aspirate would have blood and infiltrate as well?
Yes. Now, that is a very troublesome thing for all people who practice the large volume liposuction. The patient will go home on the third day and weigh himself or herself, and they will find that weight has increased, but the weight has increased because of water retention. Slowly, as the edema reduces, the weight will start falling, and at the end of 3 months, usually 60% of the aspirate is the weight that the patient loses. Supposing 14, so around 8.5 kgs patient should lose if they continue the proper dieting, not taking excessive salt. Because actually there are other reasons for weight gain also, like edema because of vitamin B12 deficiency, excessive salt intake. So that is the reason. If you take comprehensive care and eliminate all the factors, and if your aspirate is thick enough, then usually 60% of the aspirate is the weight loss, in my experience.
So actually, coming to when we are talking about that, like when we are actually doing a liposuction, when do you say that this particular person requests admission? When do you say that this particular person requests overnight stay in the ICU? These are very critical questions for people. No?
Yes. See, basically, we have an ICU set up in-house in my hospital. It is basically a multi-speciality hospital, So we don't keep the patient in ICU because our liposuction patients are very scared and they will be worried to stay in an ICU. So I keep them in a single room, but with monitor and all the ICU like monitoring facilities, syringe pump and everything. So only if the patient has got severe hypotension or if the patient has bled, then I would consider keeping in ICU. But otherwise, all the large volume liposuction patients are monitored by single dedicated nurse, keeping input output chart and all the monitoring, everything in the room.
Let me put this question in a different way. What would be the maximum amount of fat you would do in a day case patient?
It depends. See, usually the safety limits are you can treat up to 30% of the body surface area, and you can remove about 10 to 12% of the total weight. So supposing the patient is 80 kg, then you are aiming at 8 kg weight loss, then the lipoaspirate should be in the range of 12 to 14 liters. That is how it is.
So if you remove, say, for example, that particular patient, if you are removing 10 liters, still the patient can go home the same day?
No, I never send the patient same day. I strongly believe in admitting even a small volume liposuction overnight. And night is a very bad time actually when everybody is sleepy. And usually I had a paper in 2010 Goa Epsicon where I had presented a series of around 50 large volume liposuction patients. Quoting the timing of hypotension is usually between 12 to 4 o'clock at night. So that is the time when they need a fluid support. So they have to be monitored. If the urine output is less, then you have to increase. So they need all the adjustments. And if you take care of first 24 hours properly, then the rest of the journey of the patient is smoother.
Safe, yeah.
So nip it in the bud.
So coming again to this, doing liposuction as a local anesthesia procedure, you were talking about some tips that you were giving regarding usage of adrenaline, because adrenaline is actually going to decrease the amount of lignocaine. So is there some tips for you to give for people who want to do liposuction as a local anesthesia procedure?
Actually, only small volumes should be removed under local. Secondly, even when you are using local anesthesia, legally you need to have an anesthetist. So why not have a comfortable time for the patient? We are lucky to have OT privileges, which dermatosurgeons don't have. So take advantage of that and even if you give local anesthesia, the patient does complain of pain and discomfort. And because of that, the stress and the trauma also increases. So try not to do very large volumes under local.
Madam, next question is by Dr. Manoj. He's asking, excellent presentation, madam. Is there any formula using which we can predict the loss in inches post liposuction?
I tried doing this using my abdominal fat mapping. If you see, we are measuring the subcutaneous fat thickness in that. So you can give a rough estimate because we are supposed to leave around 0.25 centimeter and on top of the muscle. And you can remove the rest. Because if you remove everything, there will be too many irregularities. So with that fat mapping technique, you can give a rough idea to the patient, but it is strictly very, very rough because it is not only the thickness of the fat, but how tightly the fat is packed, how many fibrous septa are there, that has to be considered. Rate limiting factor in a liposuction is bleeding. So if there is bleeding, even if there is some residual fat, we have to stop doing the liposuction there. So it is very difficult to really predict inch loss. What you can tell the patient is that if the patient has got visceral fat, then patient must be told that he will not get a flat and desirable contour. That is one thing which you can tell with conviction to the patient. Another trick is to hold the fat between your fingers and just say that most of that will go. Tell the patient to tighten the muscle, collect the fat as a roll on the abdomen or wherever. You can say that most of it will go. Some will always remain because of the thickness of the skin, dermis, some fat has to be left. But most of what comes within the fingers after tightening the muscle will go.
Madam, Dr. Godavari Ravi Kumar, she has asked this question. Excellent presentation, madam. Please explain more about abdominal fat mapping sonography.
Yeah. So this is a sonography that was designed by me and my radiologist because exactly for the same reason that we wanted to see if there is enough fat to be removed, because I did come across quite a few patients who had lot of visceral fat. And see, patients see that the tummy is large, but what is inside that tummy, we have to find out. If it is all omental fat, we cannot see them. Second is, when female patients, they come with a large tummy, they may appear to have very high risk and high BMI patients, like the lady in yellow blouse I showed, but she did not have any intra-abdominal fat, it was only muscle laxity and amount of extra abdominal fat. So I could give her a very good contour because of the fat mapping sonography. If the patient has got liver fat deposits, then you have to be careful about the general anesthesia because many of the GA drugs are metabolized in liver. If there is lot of visceral fat, then you have to send the patient for metabolic management. So this is how we use this abdominal sonography. If there are any hernias or divarication, then it is a contraindication to liposuction. So you have to be sure, do the patient only if the patient is willing for tummy tuck. If the patient is not willing, then there is no point in offering some half-hearted solution to such a patient, which will make liposuction a very dangerous process in presence of hernia because of danger of perforation.
I always ask my postgraduates, what is the most important physical examination you are going to do for a case of body contouring? And the most important examination is to check for hernias, because the most common reason why you a person can actually pass away, die, is by actually having a hernia, and then you are going and doing liposuction and you're going to get damage, and you will know it only after 24 to 48 hours, and then by then it is too bad. So that is the most important test that you're going to do, besides all the other general examination. And other things like is, again, your technique, whether it is actually pulmonary embolism and everything. Now it's extreme. We have not seen a case of pulmonary embolism really. So because in our generation, by then all the Tumison techniques and all have been more or less fine-tuned, and you hardly get pulmonary embolism.
We are not using large cannulas.
Yeah, large cannulas also not there. Yeah. So it's almost like this is the most important test that you have to, physical examination that you have to do.
May I add one more thing? Many large volume patients, they have such a thick layer of fat on the abdomen that clinical examination may fail to reveal. So any abdominal liposuction never do without a preliminary ultrasound examination. That is what I will urge. Patients want to cut corners, they want to cut costs. They want to avoid tests, but don't fall prey to this.
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely. But now we have to ask our sonologists also, if you could share, what is your way of actually doing that abdominal wall mapping, the fat mapping. Yeah. I think you should ask our sonologists also to actually report in that lines when we are sending patients specifically for liposuction. Next question, Dr. George is again asked, ma'am, which brand of power assisted lipo are you using?
Microarray. That was the first ever power assisted liposuction, and touch wood, I'm really touching. It has not failed me for 13 years. I spent only 1 lakh rupees for excessive vibration that was happening about 4 years back only once. There is not much of disposable costs. I have reusable autoclavable cannulas. It's a wonderful device and it's a workhorse. So now if you add a heat based device, I already have a power assisted machine to follow it through.
Yeah,
but there are other machines available. One is by Paga, I think. They are in Kerala. That is also apparently a good machine and cost effective.
Yeah, I think that's much cheaper than the microair. But microair has also actually come down a lot on the price, I think.
Okay, that's so, great. Yeah,
because when we purchased our second machine, again, we went for a second microair machine rather than go for another energy source. Madam, the next question is, ma'am, so many videos from abroad on awake liposuction where surgeon is doing liposuction and patient is actually talking and joking. Any thoughts on this?
I have expressed my thoughts very explicitly. I think most of them are dermatosurgeons. They don't have OT privileges, and it is good to shoot such a video for a short time. But practically, these patients do get some pain and discomfort. And I do feel that liposuction is a major procedure where patient has to be monitored by some other person, qualified person, continuously. I do believe that even smallest of the liposuction should be done under maximum aseptic precautions in the operation theater. Because if there is little bit of infection, necrotizing fasciitis, whole thing has to be debrided and skin grafted. And whoever has asked this question should also search on the net for such pictures, which are also rampantly available. I went for abdominal liposuction and I landed with a skin graft. So I think as plastic surgeons, people are looking at us in a very high manner, in which they want to trust us, and so they believe that the buck stops at the plastic surgeon. So we should be very responsible, and I would definitely not try much unless it is a very, very small amount to be removed.
And again, something that I just one point that I want to add is, see, there is like I have seen few centers, busy centers, where they're doing all sorts of work, where they tend to actually tell, this is a case of liposuction, that let the junior most person, he will be assigned to doing liposuction. But what I want to emphasize is that liposuction is an art. It is basically an artist doing sculptures and adjusting the shape of a person's body. It is a thing that you should love to do, because that is going to change that person into a much better person. So one, you have to be very, you should be able to see the person in 3D, not in 2D. You should be able to see the person in 3D. You should be able to plan upfront before you give the tumescent, what are you going to do? Where are you going to take the suction? Approximately how much you would be taking. And then actually you should be going ahead and doing that with a lot of passion. And doing that is also not enough, because you have to be very sure that you should do a very safe surgery for that person. From being a joyful occasion, we should not end up in a very sad kind of a situation. So I think it is something that you should give a lot of importance to. And in that aspect, in the anesthesia part, it is very good if you can actually give general anesthesia or other modes of anesthesia, and avoid all these half-baked stuff where actually you are doing locally local in the large areas and the totally local anesthesia. But having said that, I know that there are a lot of plastic surgeons also who does that. I think you should take this like him. most important thing I think that one, be very serious when you're doing a liposuction. Number two is that be very safe when you're doing a liposuction.
Correct, yes.
I can see that we have one of the most esteemed persons.
Yes.
I saw Dr. Bangu sir. Yes, to join. Welcome, sir.
Welcome, sir. I'm really thrilled to have you here. And we are really indebted to you for so much of teaching you have been doing in our conferences.
He is the teacher of the teachers.
Yes.
In aesthetic surgery. And he has been so kind that everyone who asks him, sir, can we come for training? Oh, yes, please come. And sir has always been so kind to actually teach. Madam, again going to the next thing, madam, I just want you to tell me, tell the young plastic surgeons the importance of getting etiosterilized cannulas and not relying on Cydex as a sterilization methodology.
So ideally, etio or autoclave should be used for sterilization. Because this non-tubercular mycobacteria can be present in the Cydex. They are also present in the water that is used for washing the cannulas. So if you don't sterilize properly, then traces of that may remain and the patient will start developing nodules, discharging sinuses, and it will really destroy the contour. Diagnosis is by culture. And again, I always say I don't interfere in a physician's work. There are many specific tests for mycobacteria, gene expert and sensitivity to various AKT drugs, because we see in other circumstances also resistant tuberculosis has come up, has spread very widely in India. So better not to involve yourself to decide the medicines. Involve a physician and get a proper treatment done. Sometimes you may require even debridement, and again that makes the patient ugly, so not a desirable thing at all. Many times overseas patients come and when they go back to their country, they will develop discharge sinus and NTM, and that becomes a matter of criticism of Indian plastic surgeons. So we should try to avoid such situations.
When you're actually aspirating large volume of fat for fat grafting, is there some particular technique that you do? Do you use a syringe for aspirating the fat, or could you tell us something more about that?
So if I'm doing a small fat grafting, I would do it with a syringe kept at 3 cc. I use a 20 cc syringe and keep the piston at 3 cc. So that we get more viable fat cells and they are not damaged by the negative pressures. But this is not possible practically in large volume procedures. So for that I use microarray and I use a decantation method to remove the fluid. I wash the cells and I do the like that butter fat grafting I showed. That I use, I did by reversing the infiltration pump and attaching it to my microarray machine, causing expansion, vibration, lipofilling with a flared cannula. So because of vibration, more space is created in the tissues. So you can put in fat and it will be accommodated nicely and it will also be vascularized. So
where would this, like when you are aspirating that fat using a microarray device, where do you collect the fat?
There are lipocollector jars which are autoclavable, are available. They are available from Medela. So I did not show you because that was not the topic.
Not part of the talk, yeah.
It is collected in a sterile jar which has got a tap at the lower end. We can draw out all the fluid that settles below and use that for infiltrating again. It has to be sterile. They are available in various capacities according to requirement and you can choose the volume that you require commonly.
And another jugaad is probably to use the what you call ICD tube. We have that water, water. But the important things I want to tell is that if you are using that, even though they claim that that is sterile, it would be advisable to open a new one and then ETO it yourself in your hospital and then use it. Because for some reason, if it is contaminated, because they would be seeing that the jar is actually going to be outside the body, it is not meant to get any return flow. So it might not be that sterile. So it would be advisable for the people to ETO sterilize that jar and then only use it. So that's okay. Something I learned practically.
Okay.
I think, madam, that is all the questions that we have for today, madam. It was fantastic. Lakshmi, madam, would you like to add something, ask some questions or something?
It's an excellent and wonderful presentation. And the slides also so nice, Medha, madam. The last slide of your clinic, entry and exit, so nicely projected the efficacy of effectiveness of a liposuction to a patient. Okay, so it's very nice. And one thing I want to ask, the power assisted lipo is the workhorse, as you said, you use it regularly. And do you recommend this Vaser laser or radio frequency? Is a selection criteria for the patients? Do you specifically use this ultrasound?
Actually, lipo, I do use ultrasound, this Vaser, and I have got a radio frequency assisted machine just now. I have done about 5 cases that has come been. It is being sold in India since last year only. So we don't have a very extensive experience about it. But it definitely seems to bring about very good skin retraction. You know, it works on the fibroceptal network and it retracts the skin very nicely. So if we have enough money, definitely we should invest in these things, because it will definitely... That is the next thing that is going to come up, contouring in large volume liposuction also. Because it has been known that you can create six packs and abdominal highlights in smaller volume patients more easily. And it is very difficult in larger volume, one because of laxity of the fibroceptal network as well as poor quality and laxity of the skin. But these heat-based devices, they provide some hope to give a good contour even in a large volume liposuction patient.
Madam, another important thing is in the post-operative period, we always see that there is going to be edema. For all liposuction cases, there is going to be edema. In your opinion, which is the device which would be having least amount of edema?
See, power assisted will have least amount of edema because there is no heat involved, whereas heat based devices, they will damage the lymphatic circulation in the fibroceptal network, thereby prolonging the edema. So in such patients, actually I am planning to start this manual lymphatic drainage. That might help. Currently, after my power assisted liposuction, there is definitely edema, and I provide an ultrasound based massage which softens the induration that ensues after liposuction, and it makes the patient very comfortable. But I think after I have bought this heat based device, I will also have to incorporate manual lymphatic drainage in practice. It is not commonly practiced in India, but it is in abroad. There are MLD clinics for post liposuction care.
True.
How frequently you have seen the seroma is the commonest complication of liposuction. So, if it is a large volume seroma, how do you manage?
Practically, I really don't have much experience of seromas. Because since I started using the smaller cannulas, the incidence of seroma has become practically zero. Second thing I do is I put in a padding under on the operated area and put the garment after patient starts moving the legs so that the fit of the garment is good. And I don't let the patient remove that garment for 4 days. The changes in the circulatory changes in the liposuction tissues, they start recovering after 48 to 72 hours. So till then, I don't remove the garment and I hardly have seen any seromas. But if at all they do occur, then they have to be aspirated, repeated aspiration and pressure. That is the treatment. Sometimes you may have to inject some sclerosant like tetracycline. Rare, I have managed one seroma which happened because of excision of peripatellar fat by a surgeon. So by the time patient was referred to me, it was 1 month and there was a thick capsule. So I excised the capsule, put a drain, instilled tetracycline and gave a good pressure. So it recovered. Work. So I suppose if I get it in liposuction, that is what I will do.
Yeah, especially also with power assisted liposuction, I feel that chances of seroma is extremely less.
Yes.
And then we tend to get it in energy based devices mainly.
Correct.
I think, heat generating devices. That way. Also, I find that because we just on a trial basis, we had actually checked out the water jet based device, but I was really impressed with that because in the post-operative period I found that the least amount of edema was with this particular device.
It is least traumatic, but it is slow. I mean, it is not meant for large volume liposuction.
Yeah.
It is meant for smaller volume.
I was actually mainly
when you want to graft the fat.
Correct. So I think for the grafting, that is the best. We are actually done for transgenders also. It's very good for that. And we had done a gynecomastia, where we had done the liposuction with the water jet. And I was thrilled to see that there was only gland left for actually, when I was taking out through the small incision. We actually do it through a 6 millimeter incision only. It's almost like a keyhole surgery. So through that, we could get pure white glandular tissue alone, no fat at all, and in one piece we could get. Yeah, so that is actually quite, I mean, things that we have to see, but then pretty expensive also. Again, the device also pretty expensive. Yeah, I think we are done with all the questions. Everyone has actually asked a lot of questions. Madam, it was fantastic. I think this is one of the a session that is going to stand out. I think many people are going to come back and actually see your talk again and again. Thank you very much for presenting, madam. We